ॐ नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय। ॐ नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय। सो वी आर रीडिंग फ्रॉम भगवद गीता एज इट इज चैप्टर 7 टेक्स्ट 6। एतद्योनिनि भूतानि सर्वाणि तिपधारय अहं कृष्णस्य जगतः प्रभवः प्रलयस्तथा। एतद् दीस टू नेचर्स योनिनि ओ सोर्स ऑफ बर्थ भूतानि एवरीथिंग क्रिएटेड सर्वाणि ऑल इति दस उपधारय नो अहम आई कृष्णस्य ऑल इंक्लूसिव जगतः ऑफ द वर्ल्ड प्रभवः द सोर्स ऑफ मैनिफेस्टेशन प्रलयः एनिहिलेशन तथा एज वेल एज। Translation: all created beings have their source in these two natures. Of all that is material and all that is spiritual in this world, know for certain that I am both the origin and the dissolution. Purport: everything that exists is a product of matter and spirit. Spirit is the basic field of creation, and matter is created by spirit. Spirit is not created at a certain stage of material development. Rather, this material world is manifested only on the basis of spiritual energy. This material body is developed because spirit is present within matter. A child grows gradually to boyhood and then to manhood because that superior energy spirit soul is present. Similarly, the entire cosmic manifestation of the gigantic universe is developed because of the presence of the super soul Vishnu. Therefore, spirit and matter, which combine to manifest this gigantic universal form, are originally two energies of the Lord, and consequently the Lord is the original cause of everything. A fragmental part and parcel of the Lord, namely the living entity, may be the cause of a big skyscraper, a big factory, or even a big city, but he cannot be the cause of a big universe. The cause of the big universe is the big soul or the super soul, and Krishna, the supreme, is the cause of both the big and small souls. Therefore, he is the original cause of all causes. This is confirmed in the Katha Upanishad, Nityo Nityanam Chetanas Chetananam. Om Ajnana Timrandasya Jnananjana Shalakaya Chakshurunmilitam Yena Tasmay Sri Guruve Namaha. Namo Vishnupadaya Krishna Prishthaya Bhutale Srimate Bhakti Vedanta Swaminiti Namine. नमस्ते सारस्वती देवे गौरवाणी प्रचारणे निर्विशेष शून्यवादी पाश्चात्यधिष्ठारणे। जय श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधर शिवासदि गौर भक्तवृंद। हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे हरे, हरे राम 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 हरे हरे। व्हेन इट सेज एतद् इट मीन्स two. So which two? The material energy and the living entities, which has been explained in the previous shloka. Aparimitas tvanyam prakritim vidhimepanam jiva bhuta mahabaho yedam dharyate jagat. That means the living entities are exploiting this material energy. Just like, but before we talk about that, let's talk about what is there in the shloka. Krishna says that he is the source of both material and spiritual. So is matter also God? So it's not like that. Just like a cow may produce, and she does produce milk, and she also produces gobar. So you will say, oh, so both are products of cows. So let me have some gobar in the home and make mawa from it and make some sweets from that. Is it possible? So the gobar cannot replace milk. Just because it is coming from the same source, cow, it doesn't mean that you can make mawa. Mawa, I think you understand. Mawa is condensed milk. So that it will, the gobar may look very condensed. It has different uses. But we cannot say that since it is coming from the same source, it has the same utility as the milk. And we cannot also say that gobar, cow dung, is also cow. We cannot say that the cow, we have collected a lot of amount of, let's say 500 kg cow, she gives 10 kg of cow dung per day, that means she takes 50 days to produce 500 kgs of gobar. So after collecting cow dung for 50 days, you cannot say, I have a cow in my home. So you must understand that the material energy, although is coming from Krishna, it is completely different from the sarup of Krishna that has been explained by the acharyas in the 1.1.1 shloka of Srimad Bhagavatam, that the sarup of Krishna is Sachidanand and the sarup of this material energy is Achit, Asat and Niranand. So it is completely different from the sarup of Krishna. But by Krishna's inconceivable potency, it still comes from him. So we cannot say that matter is Krishna, although it is coming from Krishna. So this has to be understood. Example also is been given, which relates to the previous shloka, Yedam Dharite Jagat. That means these living entities, the jivas, are exploiting the material energy, just like when there is a factory and there are factory men. So factory is dead matter, consisting of all nuts, bolts and all those things, but they are being used or exploited by the people who are working in the factory. So those are conscious living entities who have Jnana Shakti. Srila Baldev Vidyabhushan explains what is Jnana Shakti. Just like if I ask any one of the devotees here, Vrindavan Bihari Prabhu, are you here?
Yes.
Are you Shubh Krishna Das? No. So two things Vrindavan Bihari Prabhu, my friend, is aware of, that he is here and he is different from other people and other things around him. This is a special quality called Jnana Shakti of the Jivas. Again, I'll repeat, we are aware that we are here and we are aware that we are different from others. That itself is something very special. Because, my dear class, are you here? No reply. Is he sleeping? No. Is he aware that it is different from others? It doesn't have that awareness. So that we can very clearly say that every living entity has Jnana Shakti. Even an ant knows that I am an ant. Maybe she doesn't know the word ant, but she is existing and she is different from other things around him. Things as well as persons. It's called Jnana Shakti. And by this Jnana Shakti, they become aware when it is become perverted, I can enjoy this matter. Identifying with the matter, although I can see I am different from everything, still identify with the matter and then begin to enjoy matter. This has been explained in the previous shlokas. And then Lord Krishna says, yes, the living entities who are enjoying and the matter which they are trying to enjoy, both have their source in Krishna. But as all of you know, we are Tatastha Shakti of Krishna, marginal Shakti, and this is external energy of Krishna. Okay. Let me exhaust my reflections and points and then I'll discuss also something else if it's possible. Now, in the previous shlokas, text number 4 and 5, Lord has explained what are the different elements of material nature. That means, Bhumi Rapo Nalo Vayu Khambano Buddhire Vacha Ahankara Mithiyam Mein Bhinna Prakriti Rashtadha. I would like to give a small comment, what is Prakriti and what is Pradhan? When all these elements and the modes of material nature are not manifest as in a cause and effect relationship, just like this flower has a cause in the form of a seed. So seed is visible and now the flower is visible. So everywhere in this world we see cause and effect relationship. But when that state of nature, when this is not there, be careful to understand that all those things exist. Earth, water, fire, air, ether, everything exists, but nothing in terms of cause and effect. That means nothing is manifest. That is called Pradhan. And on that Pradhan, Lord dances and agitates the three modes of material nature, because at that in Pradhan state, they are all three balanced. And then it becomes manifest, and that is called Prakriti. What we are seeing around is manifestation of Prakriti. That means Pradhan in manifest form is called Prakriti, and an unmanifest form of Prakriti is called Pradhan. Okay? That has been described in
text number 4. And text number 5 talks about us, the living entities who are trying to enjoy this matter. And explained again by Lord Kapila very nicely that the basis of this enjoying mentality is aham mama buddhi. I am this body, and things or products which are related to my body are belonging to me, and this is the basic root cause of kaam lobhadhi bhi malai. That means that the bad things of our heart, which is called lust, anger and other things, and greed, the root cause is this aham mama buddhi, which also comes from Krishna. So okay, so now what was the purpose of creating all this material world? So that we can exploit our desire to enjoy this matter, also so that we can give up the desire to enjoy matter. Two purposes of the world is there, so that my desire to enjoy matter can be facilitated, and my desire to give up enjoying matter can be facilitated. Is it sinking in? Two things. The soul can enjoy matter, try to enjoy matter, and the soul can also, by the resultant suffering experienced, learn how to give up enjoying matter. These are the two purposes of this material world. That's why if we get frustrated, we should not be frustrated if we are frustrated, because this world has been designed to frustrate us. Make sense? If I feel frustrated, some of my desires are not fulfilled, that is nothing to be astonished about, because this world has been designed to frustrate us. It has been designed to not cooperate with all of my desires. Only some desires will be fulfilled, and after fulfilling these desires, I will be still frustrated. That's how this world has been designed. Just like Hiranyakashipu was having everything going as per his plan, and still he was angry, and still he was frustrated. And Prahlad Maharaj has practically everything against his desires. He didn't have any desires, but against him, materially speaking, and he had no problem. So we can understand, even if everything goes as per my desire to dharyate jagat, that means previous shloka, to enjoy the matter, still I will be frustrated. And this arrangement also comes from Krishna. Aham Krishnasya jagata. That's very important. Now another quality of Krishna is there, aham krishnasya jagatah. That means, if everything comes from Krishna, then Krishna must become empty. Just like, if I drink all the water from this glass, the glass becomes empty. But if this is Krishna, if this is not Krishna, as much water you draw out, still the same water remains. So he is the original Akshaya Patra. Inexhaustible. So many times Lord has told about himself as Avyay, Avyay, Avyay. So he's spiritual, the whole world comes from him, and he remains inexhaustible. Now you can see, even if this is matter, it is so beautiful actually. One devotee was explaining that Krishna is producing so many things from his body, spiritual form. What we are producing from our body, we should always compare. Just because we are part and parcel of Krishna doesn't mean that we are also Krishna. From our body we can only produce stool, urine and all those things, which are not very nice things. Not very nice things, they are very bad things. And Krishna is producing mountains. Maybe if somebody has a gallbladder stone, he can produce a stone. But he cannot produce a mountain from his body. So we must understand the difference between Krishna and ourselves, isn't it? So we are not Krishna. Because if something is taken out from us, not out from us, even out, something outside from us is taken, then we feel, oh, we have lost everything. Just like somebody takes my bag, then I'll think of my bag. I have lost some portion of my energy. But Krishna doesn't care about all these things. So Krishna's quality is that, Om Purnamidha Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya. Everything comes from him, and still he remains the same. That's quite interesting, because Acharya explained this quality is even within the touchstone, which can make everything as gold when it touches, but it still remains what do you say, unchanged. Also, you must understand that this is called Shakti Parinamvad. Krishna, everything is a transformation of his energy. So if things are coming out from him, it doesn't mean that Krishna becomes transformed. Krishna remains avya, spiritually, completely same as he was before. In this example, another is an example can be given. If a cow gives a lot of milk, doesn't mean that the cow gets finished. So she gives milk, she gives cow urine and all those things, but doesn't mean that she gets finished. Similarly, Krishna says, Aham Krishnasya Jagatah Prabhavah Pralayastatha, does not mean that Krishna becomes exhausted. Okay. And another example about this is Pralayastatha. We talked about Prabhavah, that means source of everything, and now it talks about Pralaya. So we all the devotees might be knowing that when what happens during Pralaya, everything is dissolved and enters into Krishna. So one devotee was mentioning that if somebody claims to be God, so he said, my dear Prabhu, my dear God, please take all the kachra of Delhi and please dissolve it within yourself. He cannot even take an ounce of that kachra, I would say, dirty things, garbage. And Krishna takes the whole garbage of the material world, eats up, and he doesn't have to take any, what is it, digestive pills. I have eaten the whole material world now. Actually, he doesn't even eat, actually he breathes in. He doesn't have to eat also. He simply breathes in and he doesn't have to have any digestive aid to digest the material world. He takes up everything inside. So we can understand the potency of Krishna from this world, from this shloka. This is the purpose of this shloka, I mean, the whole chapter. Srila Baldev Vidya Bhushan has explained in text number 2, Kyanam Vijnana Sahitam Yach Yatva Moksh Ashubhat. Is that the shloka? No, it's not that one. Jnanam Tiham Sa Vijnanam Idam Vaksham Asheshatah Yach Gyatva Neha Bhuyu Anach Gyatavam Asheshate. And it has been explained, Jnanam and Vijnanam means, Jnanam means knowing about the opulences of Krishna, and Vijnanam means knowing about the sweetness of Krishna. And that sweetness of Krishna can only be experienced by developing love for Lord. And that was told by Lord Krishna in the first shloka, Maya Sakta Manah Partha Yogam Yunjam Madashraya Asanshayam Samagram Mam Yatha Gyasasi Tashranu. He says, you can know me completely. So what is the meaning of knowing Krishna completely? Knowing about his opulence and knowing about his sweetness. If I do not know Krishna's sweetness, I am not knowing Krishna fully. I'm only sitting with folded hands and saying, Govinda Madhi Purusham Tamaham Bhajami. Just like somebody will say, who is your father? He's an Indian. Well, yes, he's an Indian. That's all right. He's a human being. That's also all right. But what he is in relationship to you? That is the point has to be understood. Or even somebody can say, he's an engineer. Yeah, that's also all right. But what is his relationship with you? So the relationship of a son with a father has an element of sweetness. Similarly, knowing Krishna means knowing Krishna's opulences and also knowing his sweetness, which can only be experienced by love for Lord. Now it's also interesting that the more a person has a love for Krishna, the more he experiences the opulences of Krishna also. I will take little bit liberty to introduce something exoteric which Srila Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur explains, that when pure devotees like gopis, they have love for Krishna. So when they are separated from Krishna in terms of distance, they can also know his opulences, and they know that he is God. That they explain in Gopi Geet also, Antaratma Drik, that he is Paramatma. But when they come close to him, because of the sweetness of the relationship, the opulence gets covered, only the sweetness remains. Make sense? Are you able to relate? When they are far off, their love reveals the opulence of Krishna. Oh, Krishna is God and like that. But when they are near him, they forget that, and they just the sweetness of Krishna remains. Just like Arjuna also knows that Krishna is God. He will say that, Parabrahma Param Dhamam Pavitram Paramam Bhavan, like that. But after Gita, he has heard Gita, he will again say, okay, please drive my chariot. He will still become a friend of Krishna. He will remain a friend of Krishna, so to speak. So we understand that knowing Krishna through this chapter means knowing his opulences, knowing his sweetness. So both these things I will be discussed in the chapter. And what else is there? Okay, and then what Srila Prabhupada is explaining also in the purport is very interesting, that the cause of material world is not matter. Just like he gives a very important example of a scorpion coming out from a whole heap of rice. So just because a scorpion is coming out from a heap of rice doesn't mean that the heap of rice is the mother or father of a scorpion. So we understand that some scorpion must have laid eggs in that heap of rice, and then the eggs have hatched, and from that scorpion is coming. So seeing the immediate result, we should not think that the real result is, sorry, real cause is also the same thing. That means the heap, just like the heap of rice is not the result of the scorpion, similarly it appears that everything is done, being done by this, by material nature, but we must understand it is done by Krishna. Now also we must understand the nature of Krishna's energy is swabhaviki jnana bala kriya cha, that he doesn't have to personally interfere, but simply by his will everything is happening. Just like we have so many parceling. They make a lot of parcels to pack things up. But you see, Krishna has a swabhaviki parcel factory. We have this tomato which has a natural parcel wrapping around it. Similarly, we have all these fruits, they have natural parcel. You understand? Parcel wrap around them, which doesn't happen by anyone's interference in terms of an industry. It just happens simply by the will of Krishna. That's why person who is not intelligent, he cannot understand that is happening by Krishna's energy. It cannot happen by Krishna's energy. They think it is happening automatically. That's not an intelligent person's decision. And one last shloka is there which Prabhupada quotes is Nityo Nityanam Chetanas Chetananam. That among all eternals, Krishna is the chief eternal and who is satisfying the desires of everybody. How many people's desires you can satisfy all throughout the day? Think about it. We have our difficulty of providing prasadam for 10,000 people for Prabhupada disappearance day. So much management, so much planning happens. And I was today taking prasadam today on the afternoon. And then I was thinking, how many people Krishna is feeding? We don't even know how many people, and not only human beings, ants, elephants, amoebas, everybody Krishna is feeding without any effort. And nobody thinks, my every grain is being arranged by Krishna himself. So we must understand, and by these things we should become grateful to Krishna. Hare Krishna. Any questions? Okay. Yes.
When we are practicing Krishna consciousness, there is a very much anxiety. So sometimes it becomes very difficult to control the anger. So how the anger can be controlled?
Don't become angry when you are angry. We are in our ashram, we are discussing Upadeshamrita only. So we will talk about Vacho Vegam Manasa Krodha Vegam. Just like if there is fire, what are the elements which are there to create or sustain fire? First is some fuel has to be there, some spark has to be there. Initially spark has to be there. But one more thing which is there, which is needed for the fire to remain. Yes, somebody can tell. Do you know what are the third thing which is needed for a fire? Yes, so this oxygen is speech, and actually the spark is also speech. Can you fight or become angry with somebody whom you don't talk? It's very difficult. No, he at some point he must have talked with you, then only actually fight begins. So it is not like, can we become angry like this? Why don't you listen to me? You're such a rascal. Do we be like this? Do we whisper and become angry? There is no fun in becoming angry by whispering. So the real principle is Vacho Vegam Manasa Krodha Vegam. The switch is here. If I become more angry and I speak it out loud, and I become more angry. So when actually anger comes, we should try to not speak loudly. That's like I was angry with a devotee who did not show up for service. So I said, okay, I'm not becoming angry today. I'll become angry tomorrow if you behave like this. So you can postpone anger sometimes. But ultimately anger comes, again, all these things can be dissolved only by the Shakti of Swarup Shakti of Bhakti. That has been explained by Acharyas on this tika of Upadeshamrita, that all these vegas, vacho vegam, manasakrodha vegam, can only be dissolved by the element of Bhakti. Just imagine the case of Amrish Maharaj. What fault he had? You know about Amrish Maharaj? Amrish Maharaj was fasting from Ekadashi and then for Ekadashi, and the next day he had to take some vibraka fast, and then one great person came, his name is Durvasa Muni, and he said, I am going to take my bath in Yamuna, and then I will come back and then I will take prasadam for you. And then he particularly made delay, and the time to break the fast was going away. We know how much time it takes to take Gayatri, 5 minutes maximum. So he may be having a special Gayatri, and I don't know why he was doing that. He purposefully made late, and then he came and became angry. And not only he became angry, because Amrish Maharaj has just taken a sip of water. He created a demon who would actually kill Amrish Maharaj. And the whole story is there, how Amrish Maharaj did not become angry, and the chakra of Lord punished that Durvasa Muni for 1 year. And then again he came back and asked forgiveness. But while Durvasa Muni was being punished by Sudarshan, Amrish Maharaj was thinking that he was the offender. So that quality of tolerance can only be there when we have pure devotional service to Krishna. We are so much satisfied in Krishna that we don't become angry. It's not an easy thing, but it is only way we can be become free from all this anger and everything is by being situated in Krishna consciousness. Till the time it will always be a struggle for everybody. But for practical solutions, when we are angry, at that time we should try to restrain our speech, even if we are actually angry in terms of mind, and chant Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, like that, so that we remain peaceful. Any other questions are there? Okay, so we shall stop here. Srimad Bhagavad Gita ki jai, Srila Prabhupada ki jai.